Yeah, my name is Greg Judy. My wife Jan and I run a grazing operation here on about 16 farms. Four of those farms are owned, 12 of them are leased. And we do pasture pigs, sheep, chickens, grass-fed beef, shiitake mushrooms, some sawmill, and then some lumber. From that we make into some furniture. Just everything we can on the land to try and, you know, come up with additional income revenues. Here at Green Pastures Farm, we run a grass-fed beef operation. That's kind of the centerpiece of this operation. It is a breed called South Pole, which are grass genetic. They're bred for finishing on grass. And we've been working at this for about 14 to 15 years. And we switched several years ago to a term called mob grazing, where we're actually bunching the animals together and trying to duplicate what happened on the prairies for thousands of years before we exterminated the buffalo. So basically we're using the animals to beat up the ground and get off of it. And so all the dung and all the urine, that hoof traffic is all left behind us, and we're always moving forward onto the next fresh pasture. And by doing that, we've been able to eliminate a lot of the costly inputs. I say the best medicine to give an animal is a fresh recovered green pasture twice a day. And so that's what we're doing. We're moving our animals twice a day. We have one large mob, about 300 animals, and we're just moving them. And we've been able to basically double the amount of animals that we're grazing now in roughly about 10 years. I call that stacking another farm on top of the one you have. When you don't have to buy additional land, and yet you can bring in more animals, that's always a win-win proposition. So leasing land frees up your equity. You don't have all your money invested in land. And folks, land is probably the biggest obstacle today of getting young people on the land. It is expensive. Even around here, I mean, we're talking $3,000 to $5,000 an acre. Now, these are farms that nobody else wanted. There was no fence on it. There was no water, no loading facility. It was covered in brush. It didn't really look like pasture when we got it. So we had to do some work. But we're willing to go in and work on these farms if we can get an economical lease. And so you're asking, so what's the landowner getting out of this? Well, you go look at our farms. They look like parks. They're absolutely gorgeous. We have brand new painted posts all the way along, all new fence. We've got legumes growing now. We've got wildlife on every farm. So with management, we're trying to capture every green leaf every day of the year as possible so our animals can feed themselves. Another centerpiece we brought onto the farm about 14 years ago was the hair sheep. We lease all these farms. We do have weeds. And we were out there trying to clip the weeds, and you know, it just bothered me to burn fossil fuel to get rid of something that maybe an animal would eat. And folks, sheep are forbs. That's what they eat. They eat anything that's got a broadleaf on it. All the stuff that cattle won't touch, the sheep will eat. And so today we've got hair sheep, grass finished hair sheep lamb that we sell. And we're now road heating our sheep with a poly wire, one single poly braid. And it's about 10 inches off the ground. We've got our sheep broke to a 10,000 volt wire, and the guard dog's staying there as well. So it's really handy to go out and just take one wire, roll it up, and you're done. You've got to protect the sheep, folks. If you're going to bring sheep onto your farm, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. Put something out there that barks and has teeth. Put a dog out there that can bark, and they will run off the predators. We don't worry about our sheep anymore. The hair sheep actually have really nice symbiosis going with the cattle. The cattle can ingest a parasite from a sheep. It's a dead end host. It cannot complete its life cycle. The sheep can ingest the cow parasite. So the two species, when you're grazing the paddocks behind each other, they're actually acting like a vacuum cleaner. They're sucking up each other's parasite. And they're running two batches of hogs a year in the woods. So they're Berkshire. We run a batch from May until October, and then from October until May. They only feed them once a day, non-GMO. The whole secret to pigs is don't let them get bored. Once they get up to about 60, 70 pounds, you're one wire, that's it. You can keep them in. Only take the hogs through your timber once a year. Let the timber recover. If you're constantly going back over it, well, yeah, it's gonna look like a dirt lot. I'm sorry, that's not pastured pigs. The pigs do have pressurized water on every paddock. I think that's the biggest thing that we do, is those hogs get a cold drink of water, and it's clean every single day. I'm really excited about the chickens. We've had these, this is our third year. They're constantly being moved along the farm, being rotated behind the cattle. They're in electric net. It's a great big Well, there's actually, I think, 8 100-foot rolls, and the chickens really are putting down a lot of fertility. And by following the cattle, they are scratching open the manure path, so we're getting a lot more better distribution of the cattle manure, complements of the chickens. And also, I'm noticing we're getting more diversity in our pastures where the chickens have been. A lot more legumes, bird's foot trefoil. That's one that we didn't used to see much of. It's all over where the chickens have been. So yeah, we got, you know, the chickens, the pigs, the sheep, the cattle. I'm excited about the silvopasture. We've got 1,620 acres total out of the 16 farms, and 900 of that is timber, about 700 is grass. And so if we can go around and create some openings in this timber, especially along the edges where the timber meets the open fields, we call that a transition zone. That's your edge habitat. Our key is to try and get sunlight down around on all four sides of a tree. If we can do that, we're gonna grow some forage under there. There's gonna be some forbs coming up. Of course, you get some brush. Pasture behind us, that was pretty nasty pasture. It was really grown up in brush after I cleared the trees. We brought the mob of cattle in there at 1 million pound stocking density. We gave them just 5 minute moves. So they were packed into like cordwood, and they absolutely just trampled all that stuff on the ground, manured it, urinated on it, and now we've got a really nice stand of grass and clovers. And everybody asks me, what do you seed? We don't seed anything. We're putting cow hooves down, sheep hooves, maybe planting some fence posts where we need a fence, but we don't plant any seeds. I don't think there's ever been a seeding done that can be done as well as Mother Nature. Think about it. From the time this earth's been created, there's been seed dropped on this land. We're developing silvopasture on our farms, which is a direct integration of trees, livestock, and forage. We're taking a leafy area like underneath our feet right here, which is just dry leaves, and we're turning that into silvopasture by opening up the canopy. So we're removing about 70% of the trees. Those make great shiitake logs, and so we're already cutting them down anyway. It's just one more process to cut them into 4 foot pieces rather than chopping up in little pieces for firewood. It's a win-win combination for us. One of the trees that we focused in on that seems to like to grow out in our pastures a lot is honey locust. And folks, I'll be the first one to admit, I have fought these things my entire life. They're the ones that's got the long thorns on them. And so we're going in now because they like to grow and we need shade. I want shade in my pasture. The honey locust, it's a passive shade. So it's got the little bitty leaves on it. It lets a little bit of sunlight through. We're finding out that it is a legume. It fixes nitrogen. Every blade of leaf that falls off a honey locust onto the ground is pure nitrogen. The pods in the fall are 39% sugar. The old timers used to collect them. They would go out and collect them and fill their barn loft full of these honey pods, and they would feed them to their livestock. The sheep love honey locusts. They'll eat the beans. That's the first thing they do. When you turn them into a patty, those sheep will go right for that honey locust. Overall on our farms, you know, we got 1,620 acres. 700 of that is grass. The rest of it's all timber. And we're trying to convert more of this silvopasture every year that we can do that. We just need to learn how to graze correctly. And getting into grazing, you've got to get the right tools. And that basically is a poly braid, the temporary polyethylene little tiny rope. I use the braid because it's a lot more durable. And then we use a geared reel to roll it up each day. And then we use temporary step-in posts. So we've got high tensile electric fence around all of our farms, so we can take our poly braid on these reels and we can divide these paddocks up. And you can shape your paddock however big you need it, depending on how fast your grass is growing. We don't have gates anymore. We don't hardly have a gate on our farm, if we can help it. So we just raise the wire up, or we'll have a gate, you know, going into like a 60 acre field, but the rest of the time it's all daily moves or twice daily moves with poly wire. You've got to combine your herds. When you combine them, you got a bigger horsepower engine now. So you got more manure, you got more animal impact, and more urine. And so you can trample more, you're going to build more soil faster. Our animals should have a very good life, and they do. If we can mimic nature and try and stay out of her way as much as possible, not only is our land healthier, our water's more healthy, our animals are healthier, we're going to build soil, we're going to regenerate these farms. And that's what we're all about.